Peace, peace, peace. Man, when I tell you what's going down, man, you know the usual, what's going down. We have a loaded show today. We are back at it, you know, 2 days in a row. We actually got another episode coming your way tomorrow afternoon. We got a guest that I'm looking forward to having as well. You know, it's the new year, so we are, this is the grind season, y'all. This is the grind season for sure. It's time. Yeah. It's time, you know, and I really mean that. It's time. You know, pushing out content since my days of college, trying to get better and, you know, perfect the craft. I won't even say perfect the craft. I don't believe in perfect, you know, being perfect. You know, that's unreasonable expectations. What I want to do is get better and better every show. And I think this is the year that we are going to accomplish some things on the show. We got a lot to talk about in sports, but you see, I have to calm down a little bit because the first topic that we have, man, is a very serious topic that we're going to talk about. We're going to get into that in a few. But, yeah, it's time to make it do what it do. So that it'll be written. So that it'll be done. Lil Shadamus on the mic. Please like and subscribe to the channel to be notified of any new uploaded content that we have coming your way. Once again, we are off to a hot start. We are putting in the grind. We got four heads on the mic today. So definitely for more exclusive content, like, subscribe to the channel and share the video. And let's get this 2023 up and running. Anyway, without further ado, I'm going to introduce the panel that we have here on today's show, starting with my guy. They call him Good Vibes because, you know, it's always a good vibe, even when things are happening outside. So, Good Vibes by Zay. What's going on?
How's it going, y'all? I wish I could say I'm in paradise, but after seeing what happened last night, definitely not in that particular mood. It's always, you know, keep your loved ones close, talk to them every day, because you never know what can happen in the events that do happen. You know, the sports world, you know, they definitely witnessed something very devastating last night, and we're going to talk more about it in a few moments. But, you know, just want to say, everyone, please contact your loved ones. If you still got your mom and dad in your lives, please reach out to them. If you got your sister, your brother, any family member, just reach out to them. Tell them you love them, because you never know what can happen in this world. But, you know, that's kind of my little spiel before we start.
Absolutely. We got, you know, my cousin on the show today. Fred is back. You know, he's been out for a couple weeks.
Yeah.
You know, I know it was the holiday season. So, you know, kids are always the number one priority, and it should be. So I'm glad to have him back in the building. Cuzzo, how you doing? What's going on?
Yeah, man. Freddie says some status. You already know. Family. And after happened what last night, that's what it's always about. And that's why family is first. You know what I mean? I'm a father of four, and that young man got a mother. You know what I mean? And that's what it's about, family. So it was a crazy incident that happened last night. And like you said, we'll get into depth and talk about that. But I'm happy to be back on the show and with family right here. Freddie Sister Status. Let's do it.
Absolutely. And we got our guy, Coach Mello, in the building, 99 pod contributor. What's going on, Coach? How you feeling?
Feeling great, man. Happy New Year to all. You know, I saw the weirdest thing last night on national television. You know, prayers out to Demar Hamlin, you know, praying for him, praying for the family, bro. You know, this was something tough to watch last night.
Absolutely. And it definitely was. And we're going to get into it right now. You know, as you see at the bottom of your screen, Bills player Demar Hamlin is in critical condition after an on-field collapse during the middle of a game, a very important game, a very fun game as far as, you know, on paper, the ramifications of it. But everything shut down, deservedly so, once this traumatic event happened. So, Coach, I'm going to keep it with you. What are your initial thoughts on everything that's going on right now?
Well, yesterday when I text, you know, in the group chat, you guys were saying something in regards to a Bills player. And when I got inside, all I see is an ambulance on TV, people gather around, the players. And I'm like, okay, what just transpired? Then when I went on YouTube to go Google it, I was like, wow, the guy legit just made a regular tackle, even though it was contact. He got up, took two steps, then just collapsed. He just collapsed out of nowhere. And me personally, I'm not a medical guy, so I don't know exactly what was the instinct of his injury per se until they say, oh, he went to cardiac arrest. And from there, I'm just like, wow. In this game of football, no matter what you do, to kind of prevent player safety, it's going to be hard. It's going to be hard. And to see him, fighting for his life on that field, man, it was just definitely hard to watch.
Absolutely. Cuzzo, talk to me.
Man, it was tough, bro. I witnessed a lot of horrific injuries in the sport of football, going way, way back. And I ain't never seen nothing like this. Like you just said, it was a regular play. It didn't look like it was, when you see a player get paralyzed, you can see it might be a neck injury. You know what I mean? And you can see he got stunned. Okay. Let me try to get a thumbs up. Maybe some limbs, broken leg, broken arm, Joe Theismann. Oh, a limb. Not that. That's not a horrible injury. It is. But when you see that, we're not thinking life-threatening. If a man is not breathing and you got to do CPR and the man's heart had stopped on the field, we in a different stratosphere. We in a different area. To the point, can we play regular football? I mean, the kids coming behind us, do they want to play regular football? To the parents that's raising these kids, do they want to put their kids in football? That your life could be threatened on a regular play? Regular play. Regular tackle. Okay? It wasn't even a piled on where it was like, Higgins, right? Tackled Higgins.
Yep.
Tackled him. It wasn't like 25 people piled up on him. We didn't really see what happened under the rubble. No. Regular play. We saw it. The man stood up. Okay? He stood up on his own and fell down. Now, I don't know if he got a medical history of something like that. It reminds me of back in the day, and I don't know if anybody remember this. It's a totally different sport. Hank Gathers, he passed out on the basketball court. All right, he had an irregular heartbeat, right? Mm-hmm. They put him back on the court maybe about a week later. He passed away, right? Because he had a medical condition they didn't know about. Go back, Reggie Lewis, NBA playoff game, okay? He was playing against the Charlotte Hornets. He passed out on the basketball court. He played two games later and then passed out again and then passed away. Maybe he had a medical history condition that we didn't know about. This is different. Unless somebody say he had a medical condition that I don't know about, football as we know it might be changing. It really might be changing. I that's the way I see it. I mean, like, that's a regular play. And the simple fact that from a financial perspective, you got salary cap on the NFL? Really? This man is going out there to risk his life on a regular play, and we got a salary cap in the NFL. We don't have a salary cap in the NBA. Well, we do, but it's a soft cap, and we don't have a salary cap in baseball. I just look at that and see it's pretty crazy. Football generate more money than any other sport, and we got a salary cap on these brothers. It was pretty crazy, pretty scary. His mother had to come down from the stands and ride with him in the ambulance. Like, what are we doing here? NFL, kudos to them for stopping the game. It don't really matter about the Buffalo-Cincinnati situation, about the playoff implications. All that stuff don't matter. Hopefully this young man is doing okay and he survived this, because right now he's still in critical condition.
Zay?
Tua Tagovailoa, Nick Foles, Russell Wilson, Damar Hamlin. I don't know if I said his first name correct, but Damar Hamlin. Mm-hmm. These are the scariest things I've probably seen in sports in my lifetime, watching firsthand. The guys getting massive concussions, guys having freak injuries, but these guys are stifled on the field. They look stiff. It looks like they are passing. and you're millions of people watching this. It's heartbreaking to see a player go through that. His family having to see that in front of thousands of people, having to see their child, their nephew, I mean their uncle, whatever, you know, laying flat on the field after taking two steps, looking like he's fine, looking like it was just a regular play, and then collapsing. The fact that ESPN replayed it was daunting. Usually injuries don't get replayed. They don't get a let's see it again. That's not the things that usually happen. On ESPN, I saw Hamlin fall 3 to 4 times on a replay. You know, I seen even after the ambulance was there, even after everything, the dynamic of things happening. And then on top of that, the NFL saying the game should continue. Let's continue playing. After the news came out that he had to get CPR, he wasn't breathing on his own. I know that sports that we once loved playing as children is a business game when you're an adult. It's all about business, all about making money, making revenue. I just don't understand how inhumane sports can be, especially in these times. Especially when you're seeing multiple star athletes concussed, laying flat on the field, not looking like themselves, having seizures, on the football field. It's just disgusting, you know, as you get old and as you see it. Like, my inner child watches sports now, and it's disgusting because it's no longer a fun game. You know, These guys are putting their health on the line for a paycheck. And in these situations, you're only seeing how much work, how much devotion they have putting their lives on the line when plays like this, when things in this nature where, like Freddie said, didn't look like something out of the ordinary. Didn't look like a tackle that was something that was vicious or a hit that was vicious. It was something as simple as a routine play that almost took his life away. And, you know, it's just heartbreaking to see something like that on live television. And it's just heartbreaking that the NFL can sympathize with that.
I mean, y'all really laid down the footwork for me to bring us home. You know, saluting my brother, Father God, Fahim, you know, for chiming in. I definitely think it's going to change the dynamic of the season for sure. We still haven't got word, nor do I really care about getting any updates about when this game could potentially be in play. I think that's secondary and that's in the backseat of the car right now. You know, the thing that I was thinking about, and I try to find any type of positivity in a situation like this to at least calm myself down personally. And while all this was going on, seeing the Bills players, seeing the Bengals players join it together, we united. I mean, come on, these are competitors right here, you know, playing a very competitive sport. To put that on pause, to come together, and how the fans was able to do the same, it just lets me know that sports is a fraternity. And even as a fan, watching it from the couch and talking in the chat, like Coach mentioned, with myself, Zach, Zay, and Coach, and it's just a fraternity. It's a brotherhood. So anytime you see somebody, I don't care if it's a team that you root against, you feel that. You feel for his family. And that's the good thing about the NFL in a way, because all the stuff that we've been through in the league, social unrest, you know, definitely things that happened over the last couple years, you know, misconducts and everything, it reached through it all. You know, for some reason, it brought us together in a way. So I think there's another example of a situation bringing everybody together. And we definitely hope for his well-being. We hope that he's able to pull through. You know, honestly, I hope the Bills win the Super Bowl this year, you know, because they've been through a lot on and now off the football field. I think when you combine that with the situation last night, it makes for the perfect ending for them to win a Super Bowl. But right now, that's not their number one priority, and it shouldn't be. You know, listen, I'm not sure about y'all, but I've been seeing a lot of stuff going on. Maybe not in the NFL to this magnitude, but you look around the world, I've been seeing some stuff, you know, and I'm not going to sit here and try to dissect what the possibilities of what happened is, because at the end of the day, we want him to come through. But man, I've been seeing some stuff, and Zay, I'm not sure if you remember this or Cuzzo, you remember this, but when we reflect back to the WWE, it's one instance that I saw where, you know, they actually had a wrestler die, Owen Hart. Mm-hmm. You know, he actually collapsed and died in front of a national audience, pay-per-view, and they continued to roll the show, right? They didn't stop it. They ran the show. I'm not sure how the hell the WWE recovered from that, but they did. You know, it is what it is. But I'm glad the NFL did not take that page out of the WWE book and ran this show, because it would have been a shame for the league to do so. And I'm glad that they held back, and the players, they used their power. And another example that this show saying that we're not going to play this game, the bubble, you know, the NBA plays, we're not going to play this game. It shows every individual athlete how much power they have, and they need to exercise it, not only in situations like this or the bubble, but more often. Okay, and that's how I'm going to leave it.
Also, too, Lil, you made a great point using the Owen Hart situation. I just felt like, you know, I'm not giving no excuse to the WWE, but at that time, there was no social media. So, in other words, you know, not everyone around the world probably would have known what transpired at that time. Today we live in a day and age where social media is very powerful. Like, if something happened right now, I promise you, somewhere in Europe, Africa, Asia, wherever, like, people's going to find out about this. And also, too, you know, I just want to give my hats off to Zach Taylor, man. You know, when the ref said, hey, you know, they're giving the players 5 minutes to warm up, he went across the field, talked to Sean McDermott. And from there, you know, they came to a mutual agreement by, you know, postponing the game. So, you know, I truly like the class act that he did.
One more thing here, and I'm actually going to lob a question / comment here. You know, this is why I honor athletes making decisions to retire from the game early. You know, I'm not going to lie. Back then, I kind of felt entitled, right? A selfish thinking of mine, feeling entitled. Like, why did this athlete retire in his prime? For example, Calvin Johnson is one of those guys that at the time I felt robbed. Megatron, best wide receiver in the league. Personally, for me, top five wide receiver of all time. And he retired early, at the age of 32, I believe, in his early 30s. Like, really? But now, as I get older, and sometimes with age comes more wisdom, I honor any athlete that wants to get in, feed his family, and gets the hell out. But one more question / comment that I'm going to throw y'all away. I'm not sure if y'all got to see Skip Bayless' comment, because I want to address that. I'm not sure if any of y'all did. If so, feel free to explain everything, because I don't even have the full dynamics. But I know he says something that's buzzing right now for the wrong reasons. Coach Zay, you heard about it?
Yeah. On Twitter was at 9:30 p.m. He said, no doubt the NFL is considering postponing the rest of this game, but how? This late in the season, a game of this magnitude is crucial to the regular season outcome, which suddenly seems so irrelevant. Skip Bayless has a lot of irrational takes in his lifetime. This is just another one on the list, but this one tops the cake. It's just inexcusable to say. As a sportscaster, as someone who follows the sport, someone who talks about it on a daily basis, to be, like I said, just to have no type of sympathy for this family, speaking about this on a national coverage, this is very typical of Skip Bayless to do, because he's all about his ratings. He's all about his numbers and what is appealing to the masses to talk about him in a negative connotation, not even positive, not even for to be agreed with. This is not what he said. It wasn't like crazy. It wasn't like, oh, he said something that will shake the room. And I'm pretty sure a lot of fans who watch football probably felt the same way. The Bills and Bengals fans who watch football probably felt the same exact way because of how important that game was. But somebody's life is more important than a game of football.
Absolutely.
And I think, you know, Skip Bayless saying something this loud, knowing the following he has, knowing the impact he has on the community and how he could have possibly hurt the Hamlin family, is just inexcusable. I hate this ideology that people don't know how to think before they speak, because Skip Bayless definitely does it. And he knows this would have shook the room. This would have went viral on social media when he speaks in this nature. This is a man who's been chasing LeBron James his whole damn career and has yet to get a response from him. So for Skip Bayless to say something in this response, it wasn't like I was surprised. I was almost damn near waiting on it, because I know how Skip Bayless is. This is a guy who does this for a living, and he's shown this type of behavior time and time again. So again, you know, it's heartbreaking to see something like this happen, and then for Skip Bayless just to add insult to injury by even tweeting something like this or putting something like this on social media. You could think anything you want. It doesn't mean you should put it out there in the world.
Yeah, this is the reason why former athletes that play professional sports say you didn't play the game. This is why they approach the media or people who's in the media who didn't play the game. You never played the game. You don't know what you're talking about. And they'll get offended by that. But this is why they say that. Because they know in real time, in real life, how it feels, how the pain feels, the pain tolerance, to be concussed, all of that. Like when he tried to disrespect Shannon Sharp, pitch your glasses back. Shannon Sharp was trying to make a point that I'm a player. I'm a Pro Bowl player. I'm a Hall of Fame player. Skip, you don't know nothing about that. That's why they come at you like that, because this type of insensitive comment to worry about what the heck is going on, where there's a brotherhood out there to worry about this man's life. Forget about the sport in its entirety. Forget about the season in its entirety. We're talking about a man. We want to see that man recover, and then we can go on to stage two. Nobody wants to go on to stage two until we know what the outcome of this situation with this young man. But Skip Bayless, right off the rip, like you said, Zay, want to be the first one to say that, the first one to address that. Well, hey, what about the games? What are we going to do? Shut up. And this is why athletes tell him, shut up. This is why a lot of former athletes will come at him sideways. This is why a lot of former athletes don't like him. You never played the game and you don't know what it's about. And it's problematic. And like you said, I think it's very strategic of him. He is not a dumb man. That was strategic to put it out there first so he can get the response that we're doing right now.
I mean, look, do you really have to play the game to really think that it's something not wrong there? Like, you saw it. I mean, anybody with common sense, forget playing the game. I know what I saw. This guy had to get CPR. This guy was on the field for 10 minutes. I don't need to play the game to know that something's wrong there with that pitcher. Yeah. So, you know, that's Skip for you. You know, clickbait, that's how society works. You know, we live in that society where it's just like, yo, I'm worried about my views right now. That's the only thing I'm worried about. And, you know, I'm going to just leave it there as my brother. I understand what Skip was trying to say. I think people are overreacting because of Skip. I mean, honestly, I'm not even trying to unpack what he said, to be honest with you. I just know Skip. And yes, when you do have a reputation, like, of course, it's going to come back to you. And that's why. You need to know not to be all clickbaity, because when situations like this happen and you don't properly explain what you're trying to say, then guess what? You're going to be at fault, and that's just what it is.
Misinterpreted. Yes, it definitely can be misinterpreted.
Anyway, let's move on to the next topic that we have here on the agenda, and we gotta move on to the NBA right now, because as we could try to ease up a little bit and, you know, get to our regular programming, let's talk about Donovan Mitchell.
Donovan, what is it? Standing right here with 71 points in the comeback overtime victory against the Chicago Bulls.
Man, you know, first and foremost, you know, my teammates, man, we fought. You know, I know I had 70 and all, but I wouldn't be here without them. We wouldn't have been in this position without guys making crucial plays, man. And that's the honest truth.
Zay, I'm going to keep it with you just to get your initial reactions to Donovan Mitchell's historic night.
Man, this man has 71 points. Not only did he have 71 points, what forgets to get highlighted, he had an 11 assists and 8 rebounds. The man almost had a 70-point triple-double. That is ridiculous. That is box office. That is great. And that is why I really despise Danny Ainge for what he did to the New York Knicks and how he took away our chance to get Donovan Mitchell. That's how I really feel. But, you know, I say this. You know, Donovan Mitchell, his entire career, he's been disrespected, for sure, by me, by many people. In the media, you know, he never seen an All-NBA team. They call him a fringe All-Star. You know, a guy who can't bring his team over the top. Shaq disrespecting him during an interview during one of his wins, saying, you know, you're a good player, but you're not a great player. You know, you're not at that level that we should be seeing you at. You know, he's very highly critical of guys that he really likes. You know, I think that's one thing people don't understand about Shaq. Shaq is only critical to guys that he actually likes the game. He's very critical of AD. He tells AD all the time, you should be an MVP. What are you doing? You know, he talks to Donovan Mitchell. You know, you're not that guy yet. He's trying to push them over the edge to get to that point. You know, Shaq is playing like that big brother. You know, he's like, tough love. You know, I'm not going to praise you for doing the things you're supposed to be doing. You should be above and beyond. You should be playing tougher, more stronger, you know, more hungry. And I think this game shows Donovan Mitchell was the more hungry guy on the team. You know, he didn't give the ball to Jared Allen, who was 8 for 9 from the field, 21 points. He didn't give it to Caris LeVert. you know, who's the other shot creator on that court on that team. So, you know, Donovan Mitchell taking the helm, being that leader on the team was something that Utah was kind of missing in Donovan Mitchell. And Donovan Mitchell kind of showing that anger, that frustration, that his ability should be on the forefront, should be highlighted in the Raptors, and everyone is going to see me ball out. And I think Donovan Mitchell showed that tonight. I mean, last night against the Bulls in an overtime win. And I think this is only the beginning of amazing performances from Donovan Mitchell this season on the Cleveland Cavaliers.
Absolutely. You know, to pick up where Zay left off, I think the 11 assists in all this is the telling stat for me, because not only did he put up a 70 burger, he was able to get guys easy looks and get the guys the ball. And, you know, and that's a testament to his unselfishness. You know, as long as I knew Donovan Mitchell, the basketball player, even from his days in Utah, he never was the selfish kind of cat. You know, sometimes I thought he was too passive aggressive. Like, I'm like, yo, in the playoffs, where's that aggressiveness? But that's just a testament to his attitude, just him being a good teammate and him knowing when to turn on the lights. And that's exactly what he did in this performance. I mean, he's having a great year in Cleveland, a revitalized year compared to how he left us in the playoffs. I mean, he's averaging 28 points per game, I believe, ninth in the NBA. Before this explosion, he was averaging 17.5 points per game. And I was talking to this. I was talking with my guy about this. Shout out to my guy, Kenny. And I said, if there's a guy, an athlete, that I would want to coach, right, at the top, Steph, obviously. But if I had to go number two, number three, it would probably be Donovan Mitchell. Not only, it has nothing to do only with talent, but attitude. The combination of I can coach you and you being a skillful basketball player that can get a bucket in the fourth quarter and do all the things you can do. The combination of those two things, he will be at least top five in my list. And that's a testament to who he is.
Yeah. Listen, man, he got the win. You know what I mean? Not only he put up historical numbers, 71 points, 11 assists, 8 rebounds, like you said, Zay, a 70, almost a 70 triple-double. He got the victory. All in with overtime. So that means every single point, every single assist, every single rebound was needed for him to get the W, the man did whatever it took to win. I think it's the highest scoring point since Kobe 81. And from a historical perspective, you can look at this 71, like you said, with 11 assists. So it could be just as dynamic. It should be just as dynamic. Because I think, if I'm not mistaken, I think Kobe had like 2 assists and like 5 rebounds with his 81 points. Donovan Mitchell was very efficient last night, not just from the three-point line, but from the free throws, field goals. Like you said, he was getting people open shots. This dude is very explosive, very dynamic. He is disrespected in a certain degree. Not from me, though. Just to be clear, I always said this dude was that guy. And he did it to my team. You know what I mean? Like you said, Zay, you wish he was on the Knicks. He did it to my team, Chicago Bulls. He really, really did. It was pretty ugly. You know what I mean? But I guess Cleveland Cavaliers owe us that some days of Jordan torching them. So I guess now they got Donovan Mitchell, he's torching us. But listen, this dude is dynamic. He's like, he reminds me of D. Wade. I don't know if anybody agree with that. He reminds me of like a D. Wade type player, because he's not like 6'6 or 6'7. I think he's like 6'4, but he's really slashy, but he can still got ups. He can dunk on you. He can pass. He can rebound. He can play defense. And like you said, cuz, he got the great attitude. But I just respected the fact that he did all of that and got the W. And Cleveland Cavaliers right now look like a team to be reckoned with. We got to keep it real. I think they number 3 in the East. And it's basically because of Donovan Mitchell.
Coach.
Hey, wow. Best for last, I guess. But I just want to say, man, what a historic night by Mitchell. I did not see it coming. I didn't expect him to drop 71 against the Bulls. You know, the Bulls should be ashamed of themselves. How would you let? They should be ashamed of themselves. You know, you had LeBron, DeRozan. Like, come on. Like, you still let these guys drop 71 on you guys? I mean, to be honest with you, I know, like, yesterday, you know, Garland wasn't playing, so I just thought, of course, Mitchell was going to have a good game. I thought at most he was going to drop 50. Once when I saw him had 16 at the half in the first half, I was like, okay, it's going to be a regular game. He's still going to perform, but I expect him to score 24 in the third, 18 in the fourth, and 13 in overtime. Like, wow, bro, he really scored 55 points in the second half. You know, these are games that we are seeing. You know, for him to almost have a triple-double out of it, That's like pretty much near what's that guy named? Wilt Chamberlin. He pretty much a Wilt Chamberlin type of game.
And speaking of Wilt Chamberlin and coach, I'm actually going to leave this with you. Which current NBA player has the greatest shot to eclipse Wilt Chamberlain's 100-point game? And I know it's unlikely, but if you had to pick one athlete in today's NBA who can do it, who would that guy be?
I'll go with Luka. Since ever since Luka got to the league, the guy been a force to be reckoned with, man. And you know, especially the last game he had, not the one yesterday, but like 2 games ago, where he had 60 over 20 rebounds and like 10 assists. Like, bro, I truly feel he might be the closest to ever eclipse to 100, in my opinion. I don't see no active current NBA player that would reach that level.
Cuzzo?
Man, that's a tough question, bro. Plus, after Donovan Mitchell just exploded for 71 points. Because to me, if you can get 71 points or score 55 points in the second half, like Coach, you alluded to, yeah, he's a guy that could possibly do it. But if I had to pick one player, and I do not like this player, so I'm going to be clear what I'm about to say, right? But if I had to pick one player that can score 100 points, it would be Kevin Durant. You know what I mean? It'll still be Kevin Durant. He's not the type of guy that will go out and do it. But from an efficiency standpoint, from an unguardable standpoint, yeah, if he got hot and he wanted to gun for 100 points, yeah, I think he can do it. Because from an offensive perspective, from a scoring perspective, he's that guy that can do it that fast, where he can explode for 20 points a quarter or 25 points a quarter. That's how much would it take to get 100 points. But it's a lot of players out here that can do it, man. I'm just being honest. But if I had to pick one, it'd be Kevin Durant. And I hate to say that.
I got one right here. And Cuzzo, you primarily closely alluded to it. Actually, you did. Kobe Bryant scored 81. I believe that's the second highest of all time.
Mm-hmm.
Who reminds me of Kobe Bryant the most in today's NBA? That would be Devin Booker. He reminds me of Kobe the most. Let's not forget, he was the youngest cat to score 70 at age 20. Let's not forget, this season, he scored 3 games in a row, over 40 points per game. Let's not forget that he's a prolific scorer. Let's not forget that he's fluid with his shot. Let's not forget he's there. He was made on this planet to get buckets. Okay, and I can see a situation where it could be in the next coming years where he actually gets close to that mark and has the highest chance of getting there. I'm going Devin Booker easy for me.
Mm-hmm.
You know, y'all all had fantastic takes. Also, each player that you described has a high ability to score points and a high volume. The name I'm going to choose is out of the ordinary, out of the box, but he is the primary scorer on his team. He gets a lot of buckets, and there's nobody even near him that's going to take the ball away from him, and that's Shai Gilgeous-Alexander. The man is averaging 30 points per game, shooting 50% from the field. I believe if he really wanted to desperately go for that 100 points, I believe he has the opportunity to do so in OKC. When you talk about guys like Josh Giddey, there's a plethora of guys on that team that doesn't belong in the same atmosphere as Shai Gilgeous-Alexander because the way his ability to score the basketball. He takes advantage of his mismatches. He is the mismatch at 6'6", 6'7", being the point guard, and nobody could really guard him virtually. Like, you look at him and he plays people, he's just dominating in every facet of the game on offense and defense. I think he's actually may have the greatest shot to get 100 points because if he stays in OKC, nobody's taking the ball away from him with Chet on the injury reserve right now. And, Josh Giddey not really being a scorer. He's more of a passer. I think, you know, Shai Gilgeous-Alexander has shown us a different component of his game this season. He's only elevating on a year-to-year basis, averaging 30 right now. Right now, he's my most improved player of the year. And I think when you look at his game and what his ability to do on the basketball court this season, he has the greatest shot of getting 100 points. Don't be shocked if he gets up there in 60, 70 points after seeing all these onslaught of 40-point, 50-point, 60-point games. Yeah. We've been seeing in the NBA.
I got one more guy that I just want to throw there as an honorable mention. And if anybody else got somebody, feel free. I'm going to go Kyrie Irving. I'm actually going to go with the running mate to Kevin Durant and say Kyrie Irving. Have y'all been watching him lately? Ever since he came back in the league? He's been on a revenge tour. Mind you, this guy didn't get the contract he wanted. Mind you, this guy just lost his Nike deal. That looked like a cat playing with a purpose right now.
Yeah.
Trust me, I can see it. we all know he's a scoring guard more than he is an actual point guard. I could see a situation where Kevin Durant is load managing or, you know, just resting up and he's the primary ball handler and he's the primary scorer on the team. Listen, the Nets can put up points with anybody. Putting up points is not their knick-knack. They can do that easily. Right. So I can see Kyrie Irving being the catalyst to do so.
Yo, I want to piggyback off of what Coach said. And Coach, I'm going to give you some credit here. When you mentioned Luka, I kind of agree now. And as we're thinking about it, and Zay, you kind of helped me agree to that. The circumstances, right? Not just the player, circumstances. Luka has the ball in his hand a lot. All right. Luka got the ball in his hand. It can control that game with the ball in his hand. So when I think about it from that perspective, not from a skill set or talent perspective, but from an actual can they do it with the circumstances, it might be Luka, bro. So I'm going to piggyback off Coach and say Luka because he got the ball in his hand so much and he could control it the way he wanted to control it, if that makes sense.
I would say this, though, because – and I'm going to play devil's advocate. Mm-hmm. Number one, this question is not regulated to this season. Mm-hmm. I want to be clear. Because you brought up this SGA comment. Mm-hmm. Yeah, he could do that this season. It's possible. Mm-hmm. But it's not only regulated in this season. Mind you, this is a feat that hasn't been accomplished yet. Mm-hmm. So it could be next year. It could be 10 years. It could be 15 years. Nobody on this list could possibly still be playing when it's accomplished. We don't know. Right. Now, I would say this about the Devin Booker point and just add more fuel to my argument. Donovan Mitchell did this. Mind you, one of his co-stars wasn't playing in this game. Darius Garland. So it could be a situation where a co-star is not playing and you can go off and have a night like Donovan Mitchell had.
Real quick, I think one last player I didn't mention, another guy, overlooked, kind of disrespected in the NBA, Damian Lillard, a guy who puts up 30, 40 shots a game damn near. You know, a guy who's is ready to pull no matter what, bombs away. Hey, listen, that man lets it fly, and that's something that Damian Lillard always has done in his career, and I wouldn't be surprised if one night he just feels just electric. Nothing's missing. Everything's going in. He's a guy who could literally pull 15 threes. Imagine if he makes them. Like, that's how scary Dame Lillard could be. You know, he could be a person that makes that feat, especially after having the most points in Blazers history this season. Even moving forward, you know, him having Anthony Simons on his team, it makes it even better because now they can't defend him, triple team, double team him, Jeremiah Grant. There's a lot of factors on that team. You can't just double or triple Dame Lillard. You just gotta let them. You gotta let them just go off. And that's just unfortunately what can happen in on a Dame team. Don't be surprised. This man might get to 70. I'm telling you, there's a lot of players in this world. I know that he's like, yeah, you know, I'm only focused on me. Like some guys are envious. They're like, you know what? If he gets 70, I'm gonna go out and get 70. You know, and that's just how it is. You know, it's human nature. People get envy from time to time. It's all right. It's part of nature. But these basketball players, they get a little extra. They get a little extra motivation. Like the Jordan. Like Jordan used to just get mad over nothing and just go off. Like, you know, so that's something that you can see Damian Lillard do. He has a very close fuse where it's like, I mean, a very short fuse. It's like, all right, you know, he's gonna start talking crap. All right, now let me go. Let me show him what I'm really about.
Right.
Any bias for Klay Thompson here? I mean, the guy just put up 56. We saw him a couple years ago put up 20-something points in the first quarter or something like that. I mean, I know sometimes he goes through his slumps, but when that guy's hot, he's hot. I mean, what about Steph? Right? So it's like a couple guys you could put in this category.
Sure, you got to pick what's going in there, too. You got to pick Jason Tatum. This is a dude that was as a scorer that can score with the best of them, left hand, right hand, jump shot, post game. Yeah, it's a lot of players out there, man. It's a lot of them.
Absolutely. And ladies and gentlemen, when we come back, we're going to go on a little break. We're going to run a flashback clip right here. And yeah, we'll be back after these brief messages.
Ryan Day's had all night. He's been flawless, but really disagree with the approach on those final three offensive snaps.
It all comes down to this. It all comes down to this. Get the grad student. It's no longer running. The paper for Ohio State. A 15-yarder to take the lead. 8 seconds left. Snap, hold, kick, ripping, and it is no good. It is no good.
I just wanted to play that because the clock strike midnight on Ohio State. I just wanted to play that, but this is the real clip that we're trying to play right now.
Mm-hmm. Let me give y'all my take for 99 cents. The New Orleans Pelicans, they are leading the West? The New Orleans Pelicans is leading the West, and Zion Williamson is the dude? That's my take for 99 cents. Zion Williamson is back. The man played 19 games. The man is averaging about 24 points and 8 rebounds, and they got the number one record in the West. We better be talking Zion. Zion Williamson, the number one pick. We didn't have this dude in the top players, and the top players under 25 years old. Zion Williamson is making the push. Zion Williamson is back, and we better be looking at those New Orleans Pelicans because they got players over there, and when you got Zion healthy, they might go, dare I say, to the finals. And that's the Freddie System take for 99 cents.
Okay, we are back here on 99 Pod. It's not 1999 anymore podcast, and believe it's not, because nobody's doing what Mike Evans is doing right now. I mean, my guy done it again. Okay, 1,000 yards again. He accomplished the streak. Now, the question that we have for everybody here on the show and all the listeners around the world is, Buccaneers, Mike Evans, the most underappreciated species at the wide receiver position in the NFL. And anybody, Zay, you want to start us off?
Don't want to die on this hill. I don't think Mike Evans is the most underappreciated. You know, I don't believe he is. You know, I think he dug himself in a hole where he's actually underachieving. You know, this is a receiver who's actually shown his talents as a receiver. He should be, if not the number one receiver in football, when you have the number one quarterback, when you're as talented as you are, 6'5", with that speed, with the foot speed, be able to create separation. There should be no reason why guys are not comparing him to Devontae Adams, to D-Hop. There's no reason why it's not happening. But this guy, on a constant basis, year to year, he'd rather it's a bad hamstring injury, or the man drops the football. It ceased to amaze me. He's the wide receiver version of Kirk Cousins. You know, with all the numbers look amazing. Oh, Kirk Cousins, top 5 in QBR. Kirk Cousins, touchdowns this, yards. It's like all of that looks great. But for whatever reason, you're doing some boneheaded plays when you should be at the top of the list. You should be number one. And I like Mike Evans. I think he's a solid player. But Leel pointed out to me before, the man has a tendency to drop the football. I'm about to call him Mike Drops. Because the man constantly drops the football. It doesn't make any sense. It's just that. He has the footwork. He has the foot speed. He gets past defenders. He got blow past the zone. He get go up on double team. He does all of the intangibles well except catch the football. What's the little Giants guy named Hands? We gotta get the glue? Like, it doesn't make sense. It just baffles me. Tom Brady should have had a couple more touchdowns this season if Mike Evans didn't drop the football. And we're not being shrewd. We're being the truth. It's to say he's underappreciated is a disservice, because we're not acknowledging the stuff he does wrong. We understand he has talent. We understand he's a great receiver. You're not telling me there's 5 to 10 receivers better than Mike Evans off the skill set alone. There's not. You look at Mike Evans, he has all the intangibles. He has the height, the speed, everything. So what's missing? Oh, the catches. That's what's missing. The receptions. And that's the biggest issue. You know, I wanted to save that take for 99 cents, but I have something else in store for y'all. But yeah, Mike Evans to me is actually not underappreciated. I feel like at this point, he's getting a tad overrated for how much stuff he gets in the news. That's how I feel.
Yo, I mean, I gotta jump in there, Cuzzo. Please.
I mean, you can't torture me like that, Cuzzo. Let me get this right real quick. I'll make this short. Because he talked about take for 99 cents. You should get that take for free because it's garbage. Anyway, you know, Zay, you a lucky individual, because my dad got on me. He watched the show a lot. All right, he be coaching me up. He got on me for interrupting people while they in their laps, okay? So I had to take that advice. So I let you say a little piece there, but I was 10 seconds away from interrupting you and stopping you in your tracks where you lie, my brother, because you lying. Anyway, you talk about Skip Bayless, okay? You want to talk about Skip Bayless? You just went Skip Bayless on that take. Anyway, yes, he is the most underrated, or should I say underappreciated, right? Because there's a difference in the word. Underrated and underappreciated is two different things. You appreciate accolades. That doesn't make you the most underrated wide receiver, right? But you can argue he's both. Who knows? Anyway, he's the most underappreciated receiver in the league. And as far as I'm concerned, you can make a case for most underrated. You know, there's a key word here that I want to use. Consistency. That's the key word. When you 9 straight, 1,000-yard receiving, when you do that, it shows consistency. I don't care if you can jump the heights. I don't care if you can catch with one hand, with gloves on. I don't care if you can run the yak, yards after catch, speed. I don't care if you have Tyreek Hill speed. How about you be consistent for my football team? How could you be? How about you be consistent for my quarterback? Okay, or quarterbacks, Jameis Winston, Ryan Fitzpatrick, Tom Brady. He was doing it before Tom Brady, and he's doing it during Tom Brady in a up and down year, which it is for Mike Evans this season. A trial and error year for him and the team of the Buccaneers. He still was able to do it again. He still was able to keep the streak alive. That means he's consistent. And I know he's been dealing with hamstring injuries throughout his career, but never enough to keep him out. All right. I remember 2 years ago, we went on that Super Bowl run. We won the Super Bowl. Week 17, week 18, he injures his hammy. He comes back the next week and plays and score a couple touchdowns. Okay. Now, in last week's game, and I'm going to pass the rock, big plays of 63, 57, 30 yards, all Mike Evans, big plays, explosive. Okay. And other guys was able to eat off that. Wide receivers number 2 and 3. Russell Gage, I'm engaged. He's engaged now. He's engaged now. Okay, Russell Gage and Chris Godwin, they all racked up 12 receptions for 153 yards. So when you're eating, your players are able to eat off your plate. Mike Evans, his character, his consistency is why he is the most underappreciated wide receiver in the NFL, and I'm not taking anything else.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Freddie.
Yeah. You got to
go? Yeah, okay, I'll go. Yeah, I do believe that Mike Evans is the most underappreciated wide receiver. You know, prior to Brady coming to Tampa, Evans never been to the playoff. He's been to Jameis Winston as his quarterback, 30 for 30. He's been to Mike Gallen. He's been to Ryan Fitzpatrick. So in other words, you know, they're not giving him the respect that, you know, he truly deserves. Granted, you know, of course, you know, he has drop issues, but I still feel like every year, ever since he got to the league, he always makes sure that he at least mark 1,000 yards receiving, no matter what, no matter who's the quarterback is. And I just felt like, you know, you have other guys that the media, I would say, that would put over him, like a Odell, the D Hops, of course, Jarvis Landry at one point, you know, the media would put over Mike Evans, in my opinion. And I just felt like, you know, He's getting the recognition that he deserved now, you know, for playing with the GOAT Brady, and you know the postseason runs and the things that he do to help the team go far into the playoff now.
Yeah, listen, Zay, man, 3-1, bro. He is underappreciated, bro. I mean, the man is, like you said, cousin. He's consistent though. And that's what we are underappreciating. You can't just highlight play or play there with a big time drop and forget about all the catches and plays that he made, right? Touchdowns that he made. The man won a championship. How many receivers can say they won a championship? He was a big part of that championship. You know what I mean? So that's really being underappreciated, because there's some receivers, there's some teams, there's some cities that wish they had a receiver with a championship ring on it. He got that. That's why we played a game, to win. He won. He was there. He played. He got 1,000 yards, like you said, with Jameis Winston, Ryan Fitzpatrick, Tom Brady. The man shows consistency. That don't mean I got to pit him in the top 5 receivers in the game today. That don't mean I got to do that. But I could appreciate it, because I think he's underappreciated. I could appreciate that that's a guy with one on my team, and that's a guy I could win with. And that's all you want. A guy that you can win a championship with. There's some receivers you probably can't win a championship with. Pitting them in the same breath of Kirk Cousins? Come on, bro. Kirk Cousins? Kirk Cousins is not a guy I'm going to win a championship with. In any shape or form, he got the best receiver. He got one of the best running backs. I'm not winning a championship with Kirk Cousins. I can win a championship with Mike Evans. Underappreciated.
Zay, I got a question for you, because I know you want to jump in here. If not Mike Evans, then who? Who is the most underappreciated wide receiver in your mind?
For me, I'm gonna have to say Kadeem Allen. There's a man who no one talks about.
You said Kadeem or Keenan?
Keenan. I meant Keenan. I apologize. Keenan Allen. Excuse me. This is a guy whose footwork is probably arguably one of the best in the NFL. A guy on the Chargers who gets overlooked on time to time again because of the Brandon Staley fiasco going on over there with the OC issues. Mike Williams having his little burst of energy last season and having great yards. Austin Eckler having a solid season. Everett, I don't know his first name, or the tight end.
Gerald Everett.
Another one. Allen just gets overlooked on a constant basis. It's been like that for almost his entire career. People don't look at Allen as one of the top tier receivers in the league. They don't look at him as a mismatch or a guy who could really take over a game. They just overlook him and just say, you know, this guy's not that good. It's whatever. He's like a tier two receiver. You know, that's the Allen ideology. Like, that's the thought when people think about Allen is his tier Keenan Allen, tier two receiver. Despite the injuries, this guy is outstanding. You know, he has a couple bad injuries in his career. But when you're talking about a guy who has 9 straight 1,000-yard seasons, to say he's underappreciated is kind of crazy. It's outlandish. You know, I feel like you can't say a guy who has 1,000-yard season per year is underappreciated. You know, I think the only people that don't appreciate him are, what, Skip Bayless? Maybe, like, it's like, I don't understand who in the media is underappreciating Mike Evans.
The thing about being underappreciated is the fact that nobody talks about this. I bet you there's some people that don't even know this is a real stat. Okay, I bet you. I'm 100% sure that there's some people that don't even know this stat exists. No, let me get to your point. And then whoever wants to take it, they can take it. I'm going to get to your point about Keenan Allen. Let's compare Keenan Allen and Mike Evans. Because I could put Keenan Allen in the underrated category in a sense. I'm not going to take that away. But we are talking about appreciation. Appreciation lies with greatness. How you achieve greatness? Success. Okay, all those things combined when you talk about appreciation. This guy last year, Keenan Allen, he was healthy last year for the most part, had some nagging injuries. This year, he missed about 7-8 weeks this year. Okay, 2 years ago, he was not playing at all. Justin Herbert's rookie year at all. Okay, so how could you take that over Mike Evans, who was consistently available?
Oh, I said, underappreciated. I don't think Mike Evans is underappreciated. I said I feel like Mike Evans is a tad overrated because his feet is also not doing what we're seeing on the football field. He has a lot of bonehead plays that hinder the offense as well as his greatness on a year-to-year basis. 1,000 yards per season is fantastic. There should be no reason why anybody's underappreciated getting 1,000 yards per season at all. And I feel like that category just shouldn't make sense. If you're watching the game of football and you're a football, you know, NFL aficionado, you're watching the game, there's no way you can say Mike Evans underappreciated.
Let me tell you why, right? I'm gonna give you some facts on why he's underappreciated. This man only been to 4 Pro Bowls. He's been in the league for over a decade. Only 4 Pro Bowls, okay?
Was so clearly healthy?
They're not recognizing his talent, right? Okay, 4 Pro Bowls, okay? Number two, when was he ever known as a top 5 wide receiver in this league?
Never.
No.
Go ahead. Never. Anybody want to put the nail in the coffin?
Look, the nail in the coffin is this. No disrespect to Keenan Allen. Do it in the playoffs and win a championship, right? And then we can talk about this guy. I'm a playoff guy, okay? Mike Evans went through an entire playoff run and put a ring on his finger for the championship to Tampa Bay. That man is underappreciated. It's just as simple as that. How the heck I'm going to – I could underappreciate Keenan Allen. Do something first, okay? When we're not talking about Mike Evans and this dude brought a championship, that's a problem. He should have been mentioned as a top five. When you win a championship, people just mention you a lot more as, yo, this is a guy I want. Nobody did that with him, and he got a title. So, I hear you, but Keenan Allen, like you said, cousin, he's not even available like that. No disrespect. Like,
you know, I'm just saying, Mike Evans, especially this season, has disappeared a lot. He disappeared.
And Keenan Allen didn't even play half the season.
That's my whole point. Is that there's reasons why people don't put him in a top 5 conversation. It's not like he's just underappreciated. Like, no one's looking for him as a receiver. Everyone knows his talents, but something is missing all the time with this dude. Just like that's why I compare him to Kirk Cousins, because Kirk Cousins, everyone stouts, everyone talks about how good of a quarterback this guy is, but there's always something missing. Going against the Cowboys, 40-3. Going against the Packers, 34-3. There's always something missing with this dude. We keep talking about the championship. We keep talking about he brought the championship to the Buccaneers when we forgot to mention AB was over there. Gronk had 2 touchdowns in that championship game, and then AB had another one. So, like, where was Mike Evans during that game?
Somebody throwing the towel, please, because I had enough. I know my dad said let him talk, but I had enough, okay? We got to throw in the towel there. Zay, you don't got it, bro. You don't got it on this topic, bro. I don't know what you're saying right now. Okay, I got to throw in the towel, bro. I do, respectfully. Anyway, let's move on to the next topic, okay? Let's move on to the next topic because I'm going to say I'm on anything, but I'm on a pedoscope here with this particular topic for comments that I made in the past. So we're going to talk about it right now. If Mike Tomlin is able to keep his winning season streak alive, should Real Leel walk back his previous Mike Tomlin comments? Should he walk back?
Go ahead, cousin. The mic is yours.
Bring it on. And listen,
I think some of the comments that you said was legit. You know what I mean? We talked about his antics with the quarterback, saying that there was no preparation going on and people wasn't studying things like this. The type of coach that Mike Tomlin was running. You know, me and you, we talked about that. I understood it. It was a bad look, bad optics. But this is a man that consistently wins as a coach. He got to be doing something right, and we got to give that man some respect. We just have to, because it's hard to coach in this league. It's hard to win in this league. This man is showing us, even with a team that don't have the talent that he once had, he can still produce wins from a coaching perspective, because it ain't nothing else. They don't got the most talented team. Nobody's going to argue that, but they're still winning games. They got a rookie quarterback and they're winning games. And me and you had these conversations multiple times. And this is why I continue to say, and I continue to advocate for Mike Tomlin. I said, I don't want that man to be getting disrespected. That's a Hall of Fame coach that I'm looking at. I always put him up there, and you know that. And even though this year when we had those antics, I was like, man, that's a bad look. It's bad optics. But ain't no way, shape, or form that I thought that he was a bad coach. I think in some of your commentary, you labeled him as a bad coach. Nope. Now, hold up a second, cousin. Just give me a second.
Didn't do that.
Give me a second. Right? Let me go this way. You labeled him as a bad leader. How about that?
I did use some examples, but I never even called him that.
Right. So, well, that was the that's what I got.
No.
Right?
Like, I think what you got was me. You see, the thing I have with the matter of fact, continue. And I'm going to
right. Because what I got from it was, you know, you was putting them down. So when I was saying, yo, this is a top 10 coach or a top 5 coach, you're like, oh, heck no. I'm like, yo, be easy. It's arguable.
Right now,
and that was my argument to you, that it was arguable that he should be in there as one of the top coaches. This season right here is proving that once again, because clearly he don't have the talent that a lot of these coaches have. And clearly, his team right now is standing at 500 with a chance to go to the playoffs.
I mean, look, I really want to go last on this because, you know, I do. I wanted everybody to get their word in because I do have a lot to say. I'm going to try to just chop some stuff up and come back to it so I can make sure everybody get in. I just had to respond to that because I think there's a negative perception about my perception about Mike Tomlin. You see, the problem is when you have a radio show and you have an opinion, and you say something that goes against public perception, sometimes people take it as a shot, where if they kind of like dissected everything I said, they won't probably take it that way, you know? And I'm going to make it clear. I never said Mike Tomlin is a bad coach. I'll be a fool to ever say that. I said he's overrated in this current, you know, stature. I said he may have been a top 10 coach at one point in his NFL stint, okay? But right now, he's not. And I still stand on that. So there's a difference. A lot of people confuse overrated and bad. No, you're overrated because you go around, a lot of people will still call him a top 5 coach. He's not, in my honest opinion. So that's why he's overrated. It has nothing to do with bad. Oh, he's a bad coach. Yes, he has a resume. I respect it. Hall of Famer? Sure. But overrated right now? He is. Now, I never disrespected the organization. They always drafted well. I made that very clear. They draft well. Wide receivers, I made that clear. They draft wide receivers, okay? No surprise that they got my guy, George Pickens, okay? Ownership, they always had it, okay? Still a curtain. Bill Cowher, Mike Tomlin, they always been stable. You know, they always been stable. Now, the reality is I saw Mike Tomlin get outcoached in the playoffs before. I seen that, okay? I seen him underachieve. I seen that, okay? And my problem is that I feel that him and guys that we look to in higher lights, right? The Bill Belichick of the world, the Mike Tomlins of the world, they have a stubbornness about them where they don't modernize their system. in an era that's different. Our show was 99 pod. It's not 1999 anymore. That show was created for a reason. We are not in 1999 anymore. Philosophies has changed. You have right. to modernize your system in order to adapt. Adaptability is key to longevity. And he hasn't been adapted. Even a guy like John Harbaugh, who Zay came at, who I've been coming at a little bit slightly in chats, but not on the show. He has modernized his philosophy running analytics. I think he do it too much now. That's because he's not used to it, but he's adapted. I'm gonna land this point, and I'm done. I'm gonna land this point. Bill Belichick, coaching tree. Okay, he has a coaching tree. Guys that lead Bill Belichick and the right back with Bill Belichick, right? Because they can't coach, but at the same time, he was great enough to give people jobs. Kyle Shanahan, coaching tree. Mike LaFleur, coaching tree. Can you explain to me Mike Tomlin's?
Oh, let me go there real quick. That sounds like a racial undertone that we can go into a deeper situation later.
You might not want to agree to that,
but that's a fact. Because when you got a black man that's a leader, they don't want to respect his leadership. But you could go on. I'll let you finish that. Because that don't mention his coaching tree, that they don't give his coaching tree no chances, because clearly that's a racial undertone. That's clear.
Look, at the end of the day, you can say that. You can say all that one because they have Brian Flores on the team. I think they should elevate him. My thing here is, and a lot of people, they confuse, you know, racial stuff with this take here, right? I always advocate for black head coaches to get jobs. I always do that, okay? You can never take that away from me. Now, Leel, there's a conflict of interest. You're calling for, I didn't even call for his job. I just call him overrated. But in this sense, people think that I want him to get fired, right? Okay, cool. I'm from that video game era. I play a lot of video games. Let's say you in the gaming industry and you go to a video game party, right? And you want a controller, right? If you're not doing your job, okay, you're losing a little bit, you got to give that controller up. And it could be a black person on that line waiting for a chance to get on that controller that deserves it. I think he's ran his course, honestly. And I'm just being respectful. I respect his resume. He's not a bad coach. Never came out my mouth. I said he's a little bit overrated in this time right now, and I'm going to stand on that, even with a winning season.
No, I'm not too bad to go for it with you. I don't think Mike Tomlin is a overrated coach. I just felt like, he used what he has to his potential. Feel me? You know, he may start up the season slow, sluggish, or whatnot, but, you know, towards midway, half the season, towards the end of the season, you know, these guys compete and, they do their best to win. And to see him, to have this team that he had, this current team he has right now, and still be in the winning column, that really says a lot about him. You feel me? Name me what other head coach, like Bill Belichick, a prime example. When Brady left, what happened? He ended up going 7-9 his first year. Then, boom, he bounced back the following year. This guy had Big Ben for, over 15-plus years or whatnot. Big Ben retired. He drafted Kenny Pickett. Now, look, Kenny Pickett, who knows? Like, they're close to making it to the playoffs. So I don't think Mike Tomlin is a overrated coach. I just think that he used the resources that he has around him to the best to his abilities.
Leel, I'm going to just answer this question. You absolutely need to walk back your comments about Mike Tomlin calling him an overrated coach. Is this, if you want to talk about coaching tree? We're gonna ignore Belichick's coaching tree. Which coaches from Belichick has been successful in the NFL?
It's not about being successful, though. It's about getting an opportunity.
And none of them did well. And they wanted to be fired. And then they wanted him not having a career. You gonna compare Belichick to Sean McVay's coaching tree? Are you kidding me?
You're confusing success. It's about the opportunity. They got opportunities. That's the point.
But listen, right? This is the reason why he's not an overrated coach, and the reason why you need to walk back his statements is due to the fact that Mike Tomlin came back from a 2-7 season and now has the potential to make the playoffs. This man coaches behind of getting back to the playoffs with a rookie quarterback. A quarterback who should have started from day one. They probably would have won a couple more games if Mitch Trubisky didn't play. If you're being completely honest, that should have been the case. But everyone's talking about, put the veteran in, ease in, Kenny Pickett. They're not playing for nothing. Tomlin is always playing for something. The streak continues. He is 8-8 right now. On the last year, I don't think he has a game in his career that he had less than 8 wins, something like that. So the streak is still continuing at that point. But I want to see him get the winning streak alive. I want to see him go to the playoffs if possible. You know, that's where I want to see Tomlin go. Because when you coach a team back from 2-7, where his season almost looks lost, almost looks done, and the fact that you're able to muster up wins to get to the point where you have a chance to go to the playoffs with a win and then fake featuring the Bills and Jets potentially winning their games if the Bills wind up playing against the Pats. We don't know if that's gonna be for sure yet. No one knows. But I still have to say Mike Tomlin is not an overrated coach. This man instills confidence in his players. Kenny Pickett, a guy who people thought he wasn't gonna be that good in the NFL, a guy who they said he couldn't make the throws, he's erratic, he doesn't have accuracy. At that, a couple pinpoint accuracy against the Ravens, who hasn't given up a touchdown in, I think, 15 quarters, I think it was? 15, 16 quarters? I forgot the stat it was that was read. But he didn't give up a touchdown until Kenny Pickett threw that touchdown over there at home against the Ravens. So I think that's something that needs to be said about Mike Tomlin. He instills confidence in his players. His players feel like the number one players in the world when they're playing for Mike Tomlin. That's not something that's being overrated. That's not something that's overlooked. This man is playing with a top defense and trying to get his offense together, which that offensive line has been terrible the last 7 years, if you want to be completely honest. That offensive line has not been good in a very, very long time. So the fact that he's able to do this, almost get to the playoffs with a bad offensive line, then you call him an overrated coach? Then you talking about coaching tree? Playoffs? Belichick might not even hit the playoffs. And we got to put him in that overrated comment. We got to put John Harbaugh in that overrated conversation. Not Mike Tomlin.
Yo, Cuzzo, let me just say one thing really quick. When you talked about Mike Tomlin being outcoached in a playoff game, every single Hall of Fame coach got outcoached before. You can't name one that never got outcoached. That type of stigma is problematic because we got to point that out to all the other great coaches as well. And that's the type of stigma that I didn't like, that you would pin on Mike Tomlin. You would highlight that, and I'm saying, okay, so what? I can name every single – Phil Jackson got out coached before. Red Auerbach got out coached before. Chuck Noll got out coached before. John Seaver got out coached before. Every single Hall of Fame great coach got out coached before. So we shouldn't mention when he get out coached.
Yeah, I'm missing the point. I said he's an overrated coach in this present time. If you've been our coach, the last couple of playoffs they've been in, every single one of them, he's been our coach. The last, you could say 3-4, he's been our coach in all of them. So you're losing the step. Now, Cuzzo,
who did he play the last? Who was he playing the last?
I know last year they got wiped the floor with Kansas City. I know.
Okay, right. Tell me. Do Kansas City got more talent than Pittsburgh?
Yeah. But they got our coach. You didn't even say nothing about talent. We're talking about coach to coach, right? Coach to coach. All right. Didn't he lose to Blake Bortles? Didn't he lose to Tebow? Didn't he lose to Kevin Stefanski?
Listen,
coaching Brown's team.
That's difficult.
Look, cousin.
You can name it, but you shouldn't name that he got out coached by a team.
But I'm telling you the facts, okay, to back up my opinion. That's what I'm telling you.
I don't know if he got out coached. Maybe they just got better players. I don't know if he got out coached.
Look.
Maybe they got better players.
So now it's about the players. So it's about the players. Anyway, is a point that you made, cousin. You talk about holding, if you're holding a high regard, I'm going to hold you to a higher standard. Okay, that's what I do with Brady.
That's what you
do with Brady. Okay, if Mike Tomlin is known as a top five coach, what has he done recently to hold on to that label when you talk about all the great innovators of this generation right now? Come on, like it's literally my point. I'm not saying he's a bad coach. I never said that. I like the guy. I like Mike Tomlin.
How is McVay? How you feel about him?
He's the best. He's probably number one.
Right, but
number one. Andy Reid number one.
Okay, but he's number McVay two or three. Team at right now.
Who?
McVay. Where's his team at?
They won a Super Bowl last year.
I know, but where they at right now?
Okay, they
kind of
not in the playoffs, but they won a Super Bowl.
What are they doing this year? So Mike Tomlin has his team going towards the playoffs every single year. 500 or over every year.
I know we ain't having a conversation about Mike Tomlin and Sean McVay because I'm out. My night is over. We having that conversation about who's the best today. Because my point is about today. My point is not about history. My point is not about who's, you know,
doing today with his team, right? They had injuries. They lack of talent. So we give them a pass. That's what you're saying.
No. You see, you're lying too much in race. And it's not about race right now. It's not about race. It's not about it, okay? Because if we want to put race in it, there should be another black African-American who should get an opportunity with this guy underachieving that many years.
I didn't say nothing about
Brian Flores on the team? How about you elevate him?
I didn't say nothing about race.
If we want to make it about race, because that's where you're going. You said about race, underlying tones. Now it's, you know.
Only thing I asked you was, what is McVay doing this year?
It's not only about this year. When I'm talking about top 10, because if we talk about top 10 coaches, then you can say Brian Daboll's number one right now. We talking about just strictly this year. I'm talking about the body of work for the last 5 years, 3 to 5 years. You could say three to five. Okay. Sean McVay has won a Super Bowl. Andy Reid has won a Super Bowl. They're clearly ranked number one and two. You could say, you know, Bill Belichick for all he's accomplished, right? There's about 10 guys that I would put over Mike Tomlin right now, today.
And those so crazy, all 10 of those guys don't have his resume.
Okay, you talking about the past resume.
But see, if you I don't wanted, know what you're doing.
All right, fine. Let's cut the resume in half.
You said Bill Belichick's
take
resume.
2015 on. Now, where does his resume lie with everybody else? Because it's literally at the back seat. You're talking about when people have these debates with me, they're talking about 2010. They're talking about 2009. They're talking about that side. I'm not talking about that. That was never the point of my take.
Cousin, guess what?
I don't understand. Are we really losing our head here? Like, literally, that was not the point of my argument.
Okay.
My point was he's an overrated coach today.
Right. And guess what? He's taking a team that's under-talented towards the playoffs.
They're not going to make the playoffs.
Oh, we don't know that yet. You know that?
Well, they probably not. But even if they make the playoffs, the same exact thing that we've been seeing, first round exit.
So we can't give them credit for making the playoffs.
That doesn't count, though.
Bro, like y'all just ran away and missed and chewed my take. That's the problem that I have with people. They don't they try to expand your take. You can never expand my opinion. I'm the one with the opinion.
You cannot try
to twist my opinion. I'm the one that said the opinion. You cannot say, you said that when I didn't say that. People do that when they put words in my mouth. All right. I never called him a bad coach. You said I did earlier. You're wrong. No. I never did. Never called him a bad coach.
Okay. Okay.
So don't try to twist my words try to make it.
Yeah, but right now, you still got to give Mike Tomlin some credit as a coach. He is winning. He came from 2-7. Sean McVay is not making the playoffs right now. He's done. This is not a talented Pittsburgh team. That means we're looking at coaching now.
Look at the bottom of the screen. Look at the ticker. If he accomplishes his streak, should Real Lil walk back off his previous comments? I'm answering the question. And the question is, the answer for me is I should not walk it back. Now, if you want credit, I gave you credit. I called him a Hall of Famer. What more credit do you want me to give? He's a player's coach.
Right.
Okay, guys come out and they endorse him. I give him that. But I'm talking about right now based on what I've seen. Because guess what, bro? I'm not trying to talk myself up here. I'm just a regular football fan. But at the end of the day, I tend to see things before it unfold more than your average Joe's. I'm just keeping it real. Watch the tapes. It'll speak for itself. I ain't got to say none. Watch the tapes. This is a week-to-week league. Things can change on you fast if you're not on it. And if you don't study it from all angles, the chess moves being made. There's so many factors in a football game, right? There's so many factors. Not just, score, stats, chess moves, coaching. Right. Right. What I'm saying is when you look in depth at the chess moves of a football game, crucial calls, game management, X's and O's, he's been failing in that department in the playoffs.
Cousin? Only thing I got to say is this. We have to give him some credit for consistency. This is a man that never had a losing record. Just like we gave Mike Evans credit for consistency with 1,000 yards every year.
Yes,
we got to give this man credit for consistency having a losing
Mike Tomlin, we could go for a beer, Mike Tomlin. Okay, if somebody gets this in, we could go for a beer, my brother. Okay, we can go for a beer and chop it up. Okay,
he never had a losing season.
On my tab. You may be having more money than me, but it'd be on my tab. I'll pay for it. We can go out for a beer, you know, chop it up. I like the guy. Like I said, I like the dude. He's a good brother. Yes.
Credit for consistency.
Yes. Never had a lose. Great. Literally. And I mean that. I'm not even trying to be sarcastic. I mean that. But my take is, right, when we talk about top five coaches in today's NFL, okay, he's just not in that bracket. Okay, we exclude what he did in the top echelon that has nothing to do with today. He's just not that guy. I'm just keeping it a bean. And that's what I do. That's why they call me the Real Lil, because I'm going to say things that I see. And if people are scared to say it, I'd be glad to be the first one to say it.
Mm-hmm.
And be sure I have my facts, because you can't say that I don't have my facts to back up my own opinion, because I do.
Okay.
I told you about the playoff losses. Okay, I literally have facts. So nobody on this show can say, Leel, you don't know what you're talking about, because clearly I do. I have my facts to back it up. You just don't agree with my opinion. And we can just get it. Merry Christmas.
Okay.
Happy New Year.
I have facts too to back it up that he was playing against better teams. But okay.
Anyway.
Better team
now. Let's move on here. Let's move on here. Take that for data. This was not made up. We didn't force a debate. It got hefty. Okay. Just take it and run with it and debate it. Okay. And comment and come at my take if you disagree. By all means, I'll respond to you. Like, subscribe as well. Don't forget to do that. But anyway, we got to end off this show. Okay. With one of my favorite segments of all time on the show. We call it a take for 99 cents, where we give you a take for a cheap price, a take that's on our mind in all of sports. It could be anything. It could be something that, it could be a list. It could be anything that's on our minds, because clearly, okay, clearly we consume sports on an everyday basis, and there's a lot of things that we don't get to cover on the show that's really on our minds. So now it's an opportunity to get it out. And you know what? I'm going to pass this mic up. I did enough talking. I'm going to pass the mic. Whoever wants it, go right ahead.
All right, I guess I'll take it. I got a take, man. I got a clean, nice, smooth, good feel take for 99 cents. All right, the NBA have just announced, well, in the recent month, that they changing up their awards. Right, Jerry West got the Clutch Award. Akeem Olajuwon got the Defensive Player of the Year Award. Wilt Chamberlin got the Rookie of the Year Award. Right, George Mikan got the Most Improved Player of the Year Award. And Michael Jordan is the MVP name award right now, right? Mm-hmm. But where'd that leave LeBron James? That was disrespectful. This dude is going to go down as one of the greatest players of all times. Definitely in my book, not number one, but he's definitely up there, the top five, top three, top two, if you want to go there. But I know what the NBA is going to do. They set it up perfectly. When they gave Jerry West the Clutch Player of the Award, LeBron James will be the NBA logo. Okay, when LeBron James retire, he will be the new NBA logo. They are saving that for LeBron James. You heard it here first. Because he deserves it. It's deserving. Every time we see NBA, every time we watch NBA, we will be seeing LeBron James for the logo. That's why they gave Jerry West an award, because they're going to remove him from the logo. Okay, and y'all heard it here first. I don't got no confirmation. I didn't talk to nobody from the league or nothing like that. I just watched it unfold. And the fact that they gave Jerry West that award and they gave Michael Jordan the MVP award, that set it up perfectly for LeBron James to become the logo once he retires, and is well-deserved LeBron James. And that's my take for 99 cents.
Here's my take for 99 cents. Jim Harbaugh will leave Michigan and become the next head coach of the Indianapolis Colts. I just think, you know, this loss there to TCU, it was definitely a big eye-opener for him. He's like, I made it here undefeated. Even though I'm 0-2 in the college football playoff, I just think it's time for me to return back to the NFL. And what's a great spot? The Colts, man. You know, him and the owner, they have a good relationship. And Jim Harbaugh, he is a former quarterback of the Colts. So, hey, the connection is right there. So I think that he could help bring that team back to life again, in my opinion.
Speaking of coaching, my take for 99 cents, and by the way, based on the last topic that we had on the show, you know I hold coaches to a high standard. I'm very strict when it comes to coaching, because I believe it's an important element to the game, especially, primarily in the NFL. I'm going to say this. Ron Rivera, Riverboat Ron, needs to be fired immediately, or on Black Monday, however you want to do it. He needs to be gone. Now, look, okay, you was on life support, your playoff hopes, prior to the loss against the Browns, okay? Prior, you was on life support, and you went back to the guy who fails in big games, and Carson Wentz? You decide to have him in a must-win game bear you out? The bus of all bus? You decide to go back to him, the same guy who last year against the Jacksonville Jaguars, 2-14, all right, 2-14. Jacksonville Jaguars couldn't get the job done to win on the Colts, to make the dance. You chose that guy because Taylor Heinicke had one dud. You know, he had a dud. He had a terrible performance against the 49ers. Who doesn't? They have the number one defense in the league. They have the number one defense in the league. Tom Brady had a bad performance against them this year. Don't get me started, okay? And you went to that guy to save your life, to save your postseason, to ultimately save your job? You went to the grave with Carson Wentz as your gown. On top of that, you had the nerve to not know that you was mathematically eliminated?
To clarify, you said you would talk about quarterback next week. If you guys are eliminated today by what happens at 4 o'clock, is Sam Howell in consideration?
We can be eliminated.
Yeah, if the Packers beat the Vikings, then you guys are eliminated.
Earlier this year, I had my guy, Washington Commanders insider, Lake Lewis Jr., and I mentioned his job security. He said, no way. It'd be a bad PR stunt. Okay? Well, guess what? Let's reflect back to what we know now. Didn't make the playoffs, okay? I understand why he was hired. To change the culture of the organization. But when the culture does not include winning, he got to go. That's my take for 99 Cent.
Once again, y'all all have fantastic takes, and I hope everyone, when you watch back, you see the takes, and you hope, you know, as great as they are, hope they come into fruition. Once again, like and subscribe to the channel. My take for 99 Cent is that the New York Knicks will finish the month of January with 30 wins. You know, this is the take I had. I believe they have a favorable schedule in the month of January. They only play the bottom, like the last week and change of the month. They have some of the tougher competitions. But other than that, they can muster up 10 wins against this current schedule. That means they'll go 10-4 for the month. You know, I think the New York Knicks are a team that's very interesting because we don't know which direction they want to go. Do they want to tank? Do they want to stay mediocre right in the middle? Do they want to go and try to get that second round, third, Eastern Conference playoff? We don't know what this Knicks is doing. And a guy named Julius Randle is so interesting to me. I actually saw a post earlier. They said Julius Randle was the first player in NBA history who spent each year with a team looking like a different guy. You know, and that Julius Randle right now is playing like an all-star. He's playing like an all-NBA talent currently. This man is just putting up numbers that I didn't fathom him doing again this season. I thought his career was done. I thought he had a fluke season, but he's showing once again that his ability to score the basketball. Jalen Brunson, his ability to be that point guard the Knicks needed just to be able to take care of the ball, find the right guys. And RJ Starjay Barrett, this man is playing his best this season. He's averaging 20 points per game, shooting 43% from the field. Before he got hurt, he was putting up fantastic numbers, had a 44-point game against the Toronto Raptors, which isn't an easy feat. You know, everyone talked about the Toronto Raptors losing a step. Those guys play defense. You know, their offense is the struggles, but those guys play defense nonetheless. And I think once RJ Barrett comes back to this roster, I believe he comes back later this week, the Knicks will continue winning, having a winning streak, winning those games, and continue having close games. You know, there hasn't been many blowouts, including like when the Knicks are being played against, you know, getting cooked. So, they had a crazy losing streak, and they bounced right back against Houston, and then now the Suns, and now they're back on a winning streak. This is a team that's going to have ups and downs. But I know for one thing's for sure that these guys are ready to play on a night in, night out basis. And even when the Knicks are showing that their inability to shoot the three is happening, they bring in back Evan Fournier in a fold to hit threes like he's accustomed to doing because everything else is going right except making the three ball. You have to bring in a guy who is a 3-point specialist on his team and they put him back in our roster. Even if I don't like his defense, I feel like he doesn't hustle as hard as Cam Reddish, but he shoots the three. And I'm glad Tibbs is finally making the adjustments to save his job. Because if things were going left and he's still staying in the stubborn ways, he would have got fired. But yeah, that take for 99 cents, the Knicks will be 30, have 30 wins at the end of the month leading into that All-Star break.
And my brother gave a whole plate for 99 cents. I see you feeling generous today, Zay.
I like that.
I mean, look, that wraps up another episode of 99 Pod, okay? And we're going to be back tomorrow, you know, me, Zach, and our guest that we have on the show at 5:30 Eastern Time. Make sure you lock in and make sure you subscribe to the channel to be notified of any, and I mean any, new uploaded content that we have coming your way. Explosive show. Fellas, it was a pleasure as always.
Likewise, yeah. Boy. Take care.
All right, y'all.
2023, we are out.
Let's get activated, let's get activated, activated. Let's get activated, let's get activated. QB in the pocket, let it go, them bullets penetrate. When you in that field, it get real, just stay dedicated. Go!
Put me in the game, I know what to do.
Show me something.
That's another sack, cause I be running through it. I set up the play, I'ma make a move.
Audible.
It's gonna be a blitz if I run into you.
Go! When the plug kick off the bomb, run it back. Home. Hail Mary, pray the feds don't intercept her. Familiar with the struggle, look, I'm coming up from scratch. Nothing. Huddle with my pain, then I turn the